Greetings, humans. You have entered the Command Zone, your destination for all aspects of Elder Dragon Highlander. Enjoy your stay.
All right, everyone, welcome back to a very special episode of our show, The Command Zone. My name is Jimmy Wong with my co-host.
I'm Josh Lee Kwai. Yeah, strap in. This is going to be an awesome one.
And we have a very special guest. Introduce yourself.
I am Gavin Verhey, game and experience designer for Wizards of the Coast, specifically on a little game called Magic the Gathering.
Oh,
so exciting.
That's really sweet. I love everything you've done so far. Specifically, I'm looking at these two boosters of Conspiracy on the table, which you worked on, right?
Yeah, I was very excited to have the chance to work on Conspiracy. It was crazy because a lot of Magic sets, you know what you're getting into. It's like, okay, we're going to release a big set this year. It's just going to happen every fall. That never gets canceled.
Right.
But with Conspiracy, it was like, here's this crazy new idea. Let's see if it even works. And we played it, and people were dubious at first, but just as more people played it, it garnered more and more excitement. Like, everyone became a believer by playing the product, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
Like internally, you mean?
Yeah, internally. Uh-huh. Just like, when I heard about it, I didn't even think that was for me necessarily. Like, I'm a competitive player. Multiplayer draft isn't exactly what I think of when I'm having a good time. I don't even play that much multiplayer.
Yeah.
But I played one draft and was instantly hooked. So when I got to be on the development team, I was really excited about it.
So what does that exactly entail, being on the development team?
Right. So there's kind of two key processes when it comes to making cards. And these are broken into several subcategories, but more or less there's the design phase and the development phase. In the design phase, the designers are working on figuring out the mechanics for the set, out what the play is going to be like, what the themes they want to represent are, that kind of stuff. They make kind of the shape. If they're the artist, they're just like splattering paint on the wall and seeing what works well. Mm-hmm. And then when it gets over to development, they figure out how to fine-tune it, how to make sure all the draft archetypes work well, make sure no two cards are individually too powerful. Mm. They make up some new cards, too, of course, to fill gaps that they need. But, you know, a lot of the cards are made in design, or a lot of the core beliefs are made in design, and then development kind of takes the paint they threw on the easel and rearranges it into a gorgeous Mona Lisa, hopefully.
Oh, right. So they're just basically going through and making sure that nothing, like, wrecks each other.
Right.
Is the development team often made up of people who are, like, used to, like, breaking environments, like, don't you want people to come in and be like, well, like, this is a problem because if I do, I see these connections that make it unbalanced.
Yeah, one of the most rewarding things you can do internally when you're playtesting is get a deck that you played rendered useless because you kill all the cards in it because they're too powerful. Uh-huh. And so you're often rewarded by building a sweet deck and not being able to play that deck anymore.
Right, right. But that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to find those things, because ultimately it isn't the goal, like, that it comes out and there's not just one strategy that you have to play, right? I mean, it's...
Right. We want to make sure, like, you know, draft formats that have been bad in the past are often ones where you can only really play like one deck, or like, one color is too strong or whatever, right? And that's no fun. So we do a lot of things in development to kind of make that work. Like with Conspiracy and most modern sets, we try and make a deck archetype for every two color pairing. Mm-hmm. Like in M15, you'll be like, oh, blue red's the artifact deck, for example, right?
White green convoke or whatever.
Right, totally. So we try and work that in and make sure that there's tons of stuff for you to do no matter what color combination you are. And we're not always 100% on every two-color archetype, but, you know, we try our best to make all of them work out.
Yeah, I think that's the one thing I found the most, because Josh and I have obsessively drafted this now, and it's like, there's
Conspiracy is awesome. I've said it before. Go out and play it.
There's always something fun to do, even if you're not in the colors you like. You're like, oh, I got screwed out of this. But then you're like, you can look through the pack and be like, well, I can actually do this whole different style of play. And it's like, it'll affect how I talk at the table and stuff, too.
Well, I mean, something that you said earlier, which is like people were unsure about it and then they were sort of converted. And like, I mean, one of the great things about this set is just what it says about Wizards, about their desire and their they don't have an aversion to sort of taking risks. I mean, this is kind of a big risk. And I think that like, that's an admirable thing in a company. I mean, if you're playing a game and you see somebody, you know, the company that makes that game release a product like this, it says to you like, hey, this company's trying stuff, you know, that's really exciting from a player's perspective, because it's not like they're just going to keep giving me the same stuff over and over. Like, they're going to try some stuff. They're going to stick their necks out there, and, you know, maybe it won't always work, but I want them to do that, because then they're going to come up with stuff like this where it's like, this is like nothing we've ever seen. I mean, it literally is. Like, how often can you say that? Like, whatever game you've been playing for years and years, like, how often can you say, like, this is like nothing we've ever seen? Like, literally, it's stuff that you would joke about with your buddies at the kitchen table, some of it, you know? And they're like, nope, yeah, let's try that. Let's put that in the game. I mean, I guess there's no question there. Sorry, Gavin, I'm just singing your praises.
Well, no, I think it's actually kind of a cool testament to how much spaghetti we threw at the wall before a piece sticks.
Yeah.
Because Conspiracy turned out really well. But for every Conspiracy that comes out, there are tons of products we try out that don't make it through. And so right. we're always trying to innovate and come up with brand new stuff. And only some amount of it actually ends up making it through. And, you know, only really a small section. Like, for example, when we're designing a Magic set, we'll make thousands of cards. Like, the set only ends up with, you know, a couple hundred or whatever, right? But we try out so many cards and so many mechanics and so much is left that I think what makes us such a strong company when it comes to this game that we've iterated on over 20 plus years is that we just try everything out. We're willing to, you know, spend a year or longer just designing a set and figuring out all the intricacies that go into it.
Yeah. Kind of reminds me of like how some, you know, it's like you can play some, I feel like Call of Duty's gotten to that point where it's you can see the iterations happening. It's sort of like when you watch House or whatever, and every episode's like, okay, someone's going to get sick. And
everybody's
going to
faint in the first 5 minutes.
Yeah, and then you're like, all right, by like the 60% mark, we're going to have a revelation. And it's like, if every set was released in Magic like that, no one would, you know, I would just be so bored. But it's great because you have so much variety. And I think Conspiracy is a great example of that. All the stuff you guys announced at this year's panel at Comic-Con, we should mention, by the way,
so
we're
exciting.
At Comic-Con.
Oh, yeah, you might be listening to this a week later, but yeah, we're here at Comic-Con. Gavin was on the panel.
Yeah,
at Comic-Con announcing all the information for the new From the Vault Annihilation, from Commander 2014, Khans of Tarkir. We're going to go over a lot of that stuff. But we want to start with, because we've been talking about Conspiracy for the last couple episodes, and Gavin is on the team that brought us Conspiracy. We thought we'd start with a crack-a-pack of Conspiracy. So you want to do the honors, Gavin?
Oh, I would love to. There's nothing that makes me happier than opening a booster pack.
Unless it's a booster pack of Conspiracy not being drafted.
It is true. We were talking about this earlier. Like opening a Conspiracy booster pack and not drafting it, I think like a
heresy.
A small puppy somewhere is about to get kicked. But
yeah, because that puppy's never played Magic before.
But it's
really
okay,
sad.
Because every time you draft a Conspiracy booster pack, a puppy gets its wings or something.
Aww.
So
a lot of flying puppies out there just because of me.
I predict that you know, you guys being the good Magic players and citizens that you are will repackage these booster packs and draft them.
Yes,
there you go.
Right.
Put them into a cube or something.
Right.
Right. Yeah, make it use. Okay, so here we go.
All right, what do we got?
All right, I'll just go through the cards in order. So we have Stave Off.
A little combat
little
trick.
Combat trick, yeah. Yep. Turn the Tide, which is a card. a Johnny Sunstriker.
Two lifelink.
Nothing I've seen so far that's like, okay, usually when I'm going through a booster pack, what I look for are things that are really going to pull me in a direction. You know,
right,
or like
right.
that first pick, I want something strong that's going to take me somewhere. And none of these are quite doing it yet. But then we get to card four, which is Vent Sentinel.
Ooh.
And I'm not sure, you know, just come to keep in your mind, but I love the Vent Sentinel deck. It's great in Conspiracy because you can be a little defensive. You have all these defenders.
Yeah.
No one wants to attack you. And then you just systematically take people out.
I have such fond memories of this card from Rise of the Eldrazi. And I got to be honest, like I really have wanted to make it work. And I just haven't been able to really.
We saw our friend Sam did. He drafted Defender, Cinderwalls, Vent Sentinels, and the Chariot.
Warmonger's Chariot. So he's attacking you with a 5-5 on turn
three.
But he still didn't win. It's
yeah.
I want it to work bad, but I haven't been able to make it work.
I've won a fair amount of games with it, but
it is great just being like, and you die.
You need those flying gargoyle walls.
Yeah.
If you don't have those, I think the deck is it's not going to win.
It's hard because
people can see it coming.
Yeah, they see it coming. They're like, uh-oh, he's the Vent Sentinel guy. We're not going to let this happen to us again. Like, it works. It's a great trick if your opponent doesn't know what's going on. The problem is the text is literally written on the Magic card,
yeah.
So it gets tricky. Chartooth Cougar, fine.
4/4 fire breathing.
It's a bit expensive.
Oh, it has its mountain cycling.
Mountain cycling,
right?
yeah.
Yeah.
Echoing Courage, which is, you know.
In the token deck, it's actually strong.
Yeah
it's totally
definitely.
Fine card. Still, nothing is like, you know, striking out to me. Vent Sentinel is like the first thing I see that's like, okay, this is something I want to take. Grudge Keeper.
Okay. That's I mean,
for
if
the
you're
vote
going black, white,
voting,
that's.
Yep. If you want to go black, white voting,
playing
great.
A few of those can definitely be nice.
I'd still probably take the really heavy Vent Sentinel commitment over the Grudge Keeper.
Yeah, I agree.
Mm-hmm. Just because, especially, you want to take a card that, like, if you take Vent Sentinel, you can maybe just cut off defenders and just get all of them that come
right.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
And no one's even going to know what's
Does
happening.
Does that mean you think the Vent Sentinel deck is stronger than the Vote deck?
I do think the Vent Sentinel deck is, well, it's got better synergies than the Vote deck.
Yeah.
Like, when the Vote deck comes together, you're playing with, like, a bunch of reasonable cards, and that works out. But, and it's going to be good no matter, like, how much voting stuff you get. Or with the Defender deck,
right.
It's way higher variance. Like,
right.
If you get it all, it's awesome. And if you only have one Vent Sentinel, it's a little sketchy.
Yeah, right. A little sketchy. Oh, my gosh.
just a tad.
Just a tiny bit sketchy.
I mean, I would normally pass Vent Sentinel here and hope it wheels. even if I thought I wanted to go into that, because then I would know, like, okay, I'm going to get all the defenders from here on out.
Well, and a big question, and this is something you don't think about in a normal draft right here, is how many players are at your table.
Yeah, which is a, yeah, we talked about that in our set review, which is like, that's a really important part of the equation.
Because if there are four players, it means you're way more likely to get it back. Although it also means that there's less to be open in the draft too.
Yeah.
So you have less you can see. So it's harder to go down this kind of like linear defender strategy if they're just less boosters, because you're just going to see less of the cards you want
to
see.
It also means that you're going to have to kill four players with your Vent Sentinels instead of three, or, you know.
You just got to get the others to kill themselves.
Yeah, exactly.
We got Rap and Vigor, which is, it's a fine, you know, it's a
this
fine.
It's like the combat trick
23rd
pack.
Card, right? Yeah, if you like combat, this is going good for you. Okay. Then we
I've
get to
never played a Rap and Vigor. Ooh.
Then we get to Assassinate, which is nice.
That's a solid card.
Removal spells are awesome, of course. In draft, you always want your removal spells highly. I take them a little lower in Conspiracy, though, just because four
so
players.
Much stuff. Yeah.
It's not card parity like it normally is. It's actually card disadvantage. Also, that one's sorcery speed, and normally in multiplayer, like, you don't know who's coming at you. It's not like in 1-on-1 where I know that guy's going to attack me, so I want to kill this creature. A lot of times you're like, I don't want to kill that creature unless it comes at me, and then I want to kill it. But with sorcery speed stuff, just not as good.
Yeah, it's hard to make that one work as well as you want to sometimes.
It's still a strong card. I mean, it still kills something.
Well, it's like, you know that you're only going to have a few removal options across the board, you know, in every set. So when you're drafting it, you need to know, like, well, there's a good chance I'm not going to see any more removal in black, except for, like, this card or this card. It's like, so you're like, ugh, I want to, but sorcery speed.
This doesn't always work for a lot of reasons, but I like to believe that if I just pass it, other people will kill other people's creatures, and it'll all be okay. It's like, you just kill each other's creatures. I'll just then sentinel you at the end of your turn.
Yeah.
Okay. Stasis Cell.
Okay.
That's okay.
That's fun.
It's probably better in this than it's ever been, because you can move it around. So I can, like, keep your guy tapped, then when your turn's over, keep the next guy's thing tapped. I mean, you need a lot of mana.
And,
but.
Well, the thing is, I mean, the mana cost isn't too bad, because it's a multiplayer game. You're going to get more mana just out in general. But
you still need 8 mana to do it twice. It's kind of...
What we like to call this is kind of like a more rattlesnake card, but it's also like, if you attack me, this is going on your creature.
Right.
So don't do that, right? And people are like, okay, all right, I want to attack you. I like it, you know, I like being able to have that kind of like weight to throw around, because no one wants their creature to go away. So it's a lot of games of Conspiracy. If you're playing with a politic heavy crowd, it can just be one based on like getting other people to attack each other alone.
Yeah, it's one of those Sun Tzu cards.
Yeah, it's very easy to get people to attack each other, I found, by the way. It's just, you just need to convince them that you're not the target.
Right, power of suggestion.
And you can help. Yeah, power of suggestion. Just a simple like push in the right direction, and people will want to whatever you want them to do.
Let's see, so we've got Fires of Yavimaya.
Okay,
Fires of
Yavi. It's two colors. It's always tough to, I mean, that is a card that could
push
in one direction.
First picking a two-color card is always risky.
And looking within the pack, if it is going to come back to you, you could do Fires of Yavimaya and Event Sentinel to pop out and just.
I find haste to be not as important in multiplayer too, because how often are you really like dropping a creature and attacking it with immediately? It's just not, multiplayer is not generally that aggressive. So this is maybe to me less powerful than it normally be.
Right. It's a good way to get a target on your head too, right? If you start slamming down creatures and attacking a player, well, A, you're going to be wide open because you're attacking.
Yeah, you're tapped out.
Yeah, B, I mean, it's going to be like, well, you're attacking me, so we're not going to attack you.
Also, if you're at like 4 or 5 life and somebody's got that out, then they have the chance to just kill you on their turn without you even being able to do anything. You almost have to try and kill them. Like, you know, whereas normally if they don't have that out, you don't have to go at them. But if you don't have a flyer, let's say, and they've got Fires of Yavimaya out and you're at 4, you know, and they're low life, you have to try and kill them because they can just drop something and kill you. Yeah. So it's sort of a sitting out there and putting a target on you, as you said.
And generally, I don't like to take two-color cards first unless they're really, really strong just because it commits you right away. And I think it's really important to not be beholden to your first pick, to be able to switch out of it if you want to.
Yeah.
And this isn't, you know, really strong enough, though, I think, to warrant picking first. But it's great to keep in mind. Like, it's like, oh, if this is a four-person table, I could pass this. Maybe you'll get it back fifth. Maybe you want to be red-green if the good cards come.
Right.
There it is. Wakestone Gargoyle is the next card.
That's the one we're talking about. See, here, this is where I'd take that card and hope the Vent Sentinel wield.
Right.
Unless I was in a huge... unless it's a full draft of 8, but if it was 4 or 5, I think I would. That's
right. In a 4-player draft, you could take either one and hope the other one comes back. It's actually,
it's a decent body for
the Gargoyle is actually
itself.
Right.
It's good by
good
itself.
On its own.
Yeah, and but the way multiplayer works is like, even if I have a 3-4 flyer without defender, I often play it like I would that card, which is I play it, I don't do anything with it until I've got a strong board presence and I can safely attack with it, and then I attack with it later. Like, how often do you really drop your 3-4 flyer and then just start wailing away with it?
Yeah.
You know, a lot of times you just use it on defense at first.
Well, and if you're playing, you should be able to activate the turn that it can attack if you really want to. But really,
Definitely can. Yeah,
it's nice. I mean, like the fact that he does 3 in the air for anyone attacking him, like if he's defending, that's pretty solid.
I don't know if there's anything below rare that naturally gets through it in the air in this set. Is there? There's not a 4-4 flyer. There's that Shoreline Ranger. It's a 3-4.
Claw Transmuter is 3/1.
Yeah, Custody Squire is a 3/3. I don't think there's anything that just naturally gets through it in the air.
It's definitely hard to deal
with. The lower,
yeah,
for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, I can't think of it off the top of my head, but you know, like Claw Transmuter could technically, like, you attack with this,
switch it around.
Yeah.
I think this is actually really interesting.
It trades. I mean, that's not so bad.
Right. Yeah. You killed off their thing they were holding
up.
Yeah. This is actually really interesting because you could argue, I think, for Vent Sentinel or the Gargoyle here, mm-hmm. because the thing about Vent Sentinel is, like, it signals an entire deck, where Wastestone and Gargoyle is just a strong card. So if you pick the Sentinel first, you're more likely to set yourself up for the Defender deck. Or if you pick the Gargoyle first, you're more likely to just have, like, a good card.
A good white card,
that,
yeah.
Maybe someone takes the Sentinel and then you get cut off of Defenders. Who knows?
But the Sentinel, to me, feels like almost picking a two-color card in that you're committing to a certain deck, right? Yeah. Whereas the Gargoyle feels like taking a monocolor card that you could then move into those two colors you want later.
Right. Yeah, I think out of those two, I would take the Gargoyle over the Sentinel also. But I think it's an interesting discussion. Okay, next up, we've got Morcut Banshee.
Oh, yes. That's a great one.
This pack really turned around here in the uncommons.
Yeah.
The commons were pretty lackluster, but the uncommons got a few spicy ones.
Yeah.
I mean, killing off a thing, it's pretty easy to get Morbid to trigger, you know? And even in Conspiracy, it's easy to be like, look, I'm just going to attack you with my 1/1, block so we can kill off his dude, right?
Right.
You know, you work
That's
together.
What I say, yeah. I think Morbid's actually more powerful in this set because you can work with another player to get that Morbid trigger so that you can
so
kill
easy
something
for
you don't
want to kill. Yeah, sure, I'll block. No, like, you're not going to do a combat trigger. Like, no, I just want him to die. Easy.
Right, and no one gets sad when it's like, can I attack you and you can kill off my creature? You're like,
yeah,
that sounds great.
That's fine.
I'm in.
Yeah, all right.
At rare, we've got a pretty spicier one.
This is my favorite card in the set because it always destroys when it hits the table. It does draw all the aggro, but if you start instant speeding spirits out every turn, it's like, I'll take it.
It's Custody Soulbinders for those who cannot see
it. I just started talking about it. Custody Soulbinders, yeah.
I don't know what... I mean, as far as I'm concerned, I can see it, so I don't know why anybody would not be able to see this.
I mean, right here in front of me. Have we ever seen it come out as less than like a 12-12?
No,
I mean, that's the minimum it is. It's always a 12-12.
I flashed it once with the Glimmerpoint Stag.
Oh, Glimmerpoint.
And it came back even bigger.
Yeah, like two or three. He made like two or three spirits and then flashed it, and then it was even bigger than it was before. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, all these guys, I mean, there's a cycle of these five cards, and they're all crazy powerful. And the thing is, though, Conspiracy... Like, they come out with a million counters, but they're all things you can deal with. There's enough removal spells going around. Mm-hmm. They put a target on your head, right?
Vampire Hexmage gets rid of all of them.
Right. But they are still super powerful, and this is probably... And it's also a non-committal card, right? It's even less committal than the Wakestone Gargoyle.
Yep.
So this is definitely what I'm leaning toward right now.
Yeah.
Good rare to open. And then finally, we've got our Conspiracy, which is the powerful Whisper Gear Snake.
Whisper Gear Snake. It's powerfully annoying is what it is. It's powerful. When somebody else opens up your booster and then taunts you while they're looking at it, that's...
I feel like that's some high-level drafting techniques that every time someone sees it, it's like, I just don't want to do the brain power. Yeah.
I don't want to think of the best way to use this.
I'm going to take the one that has the biggest numbers on it.
I'm just going to draft it face down. I'm going to think about it.
Yeah. Okay, so what are we looking here? I mean, to me, it's Assassinate, the Wakestone Gargoyle, the Morcrut, and, I mean, the Custody Soulbinders.
Yeah, it's interesting. Normally, I feel like you want to pick most conspiracies really high in conspiracy draft. The conspiracies are so strong. They just ensure that, like, they pump up your other cards.
Makes your deck so much more effective.
Yeah, you're usually going to have 23 good cards to play anyway, so why not have some cards off to the side doing something?
Mm-hmm.
But Whisper Gear Sneak is not exactly the epitome of conspiracies.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of good stuff in this pack, but I'm going to have to go with the Soulbinders.
Yeah, like,
it's a crazy strong rare.
It's so strong.
It's one of the strongest rares. That whole cycle is strong, but that card is head and shoulders above. Only the red one has a chance to be equal to that one, to me. And
Yeah.
And in this set, like, 1/1 flyers are really, really powerful.
Mm-hmm.
The really interesting question to me, and this is kind of like a higher level draft thing, is let's say you take the Soulbinder, so you just take that out of the equation. What is the next person going to take?
Take Morcrut, or they're going to take Gargoyle, probably.
The thing is, if they take that Gargoyle, it's like, I would love, if I'm going into white because of the Soulbinder, it's like, the Gargoyle is a great card.
The only thing I would say on that end is if you take Morcrut, which I think is probably the second pick, then Assassinate's there, and then they might go into black. So you've got the problem with your top two picks, so you might as well just take the best one, right?
Right, and often I'm actually not that concerned about the person to my left going into the same color as me right away. Because especially first pick, first back, I can just cut them out of it.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, you know, okay, you take the Wakestone Gargoyle, great. I'm just going to take four more white cards in a row. And
what are you going to do? Stick around? Yeah.
Right. Because the person to the right always has the advantage, right?
Mm-hmm.
The trick is you want to listen to your neighbor on the right. So, you know, maybe they take that, but then you cut them off and they listen, or they don't and they just have a horrible deck.
Yeah.
Which happens.
But it's good, really good to keep in mind, especially for, you know, when second pack rolls around. And also just like, look at the cards and see what you think is going to get taken. Like, if we identified the strongest cards as, like, Sentinel, Assassinate, Wakestone Gargoyle, Moorcut Banshee, and then you get your pack back and one of them is left, maybe it's like, okay, which one is left? Which one didn't somebody take? If maybe two are left, right? Like, maybe Event Sentinel and a Wakestone Gargoyle are still there.
You know, nobody's in white. Nobody's
in white. No one wants to even think about the defenders. Yeah.
Right, and then you're like, okay, snap up that Gargoyle and try and get the Sentinel on the next to go around, and then you, you know, kind of start coalescing an archetype. So this is a pretty interesting pack, though. I mean, the Soulbinders was, I think, is the right pick, but there's a lot of really interesting choices.
If the Soulbinders wasn't in there, if it was a junk rare, what would you say is the next pick?
It's actually a pretty hard pack if you take away that Soulbinders. I think it's quite interesting. I think I would lean toward the Gargoyle.
Really?
But I couldn't blame anyone for taking the Banshee. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think they're both great choices. I just, I mean, I love having something that is both evasive and also fits into an archetype really well right away.
I think I would take the Gargoyle actually too, because the flyers just scare me in this set. It's so often that you look around and like somebody's just
How often
they're
you
in total control of the game, because only because they can hit people that nobody else can. Like they, like there's always gonna be one or two players that don't have flyers, and so
how often are you like also like you're like, gosh, okay, I'm like at 15 solid creatures, I just want a couple more, and if you see a flyer come around, it's almost like a thank goodness. Like having flying on there in general, just because you know there are spirits tokens, spirit tokens, there's so much other stuff around that can like
even just one flyer will often just stop somebody who has three or four flyers from coming at you, because they can easily go at one of the other two players, and then we were doing what you want to do, which is like they just go at it and I just watch, and then I just clean up when the dust settles, which is basically how you win multiplayer most of the time.
Absolutely. I mean, it's, you know, it's so easy once in the power of suggestion thing. It's like, oh, I've got this flyer. Attack the guy who has no flyers, maybe, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
It's also, from the sort of political standpoint, the fact that it has Defender on it is actually in, can be in your to your advantage, because it's not, like, if you play a 3-4 flyer, that's it. It's actually more threatening to somebody than your 3-4 flyer with Defender. So you're like, it's just to defend. It says it right on the card. Yeah. I mean, you ignore that rest of that other part where
you
can attack with it.
I don't even have
it.
The mana to make him into whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, it's like, oh, I'm quote-unquote opting to play a 4-drop or another 5-card drop on the next turn, right? I'm not attacking you with my guy. Look at how nice I am, man.
Right,
yeah.
And then you're, you know, the mafia boss. And
hey, yeah, let me cut you a deal.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a solid pack, though. I Soulbinders all the way, of course.
Yeah. All right.
For me, at least.
I think we're in agreement.
I think I first picked that more than any other card, because every time I see it come around, I'm like,
well, I mean,
usually I'm playing something.
I don't think there's an uncommon or common in the set you would pick over it. Is there a conspiracy or a, like, I know Gavin has this strategy of like take all the conspiracies basically all the time. Would you take any conspiracy over that Soulbinders, or is it powerful enough to?
I could definitely see taking a conspiracy over it. I think I wouldn't take like maybe one of the weaker hidden agendas, maybe, but like a backup plans where you get the two opening hands is really strong. You know, there might be a few I would consider. It's also, once again, the conspiracies always make your deck, just because they're always going to do something, unless you're like Whisper Gear Sneak, which isn't really a conspiracy. and so you're guaranteed to play them, and you're guaranteed to help your other cards out. And you're, I found in conspiracy, the packs are powerful enough that you're basically always going to have enough cards you want to play.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'd rather just take like the thing that's going to make my deck and be like a, you know, an extra card, bonus free card. Of course, when you're up against Custody Soulbinders, which is a bomb rare, it's hard to choose.
That's what I mean. Is that on the level of... I think for me, like, I don't think I would take... I mean, I would take World Knit just because I haven't played it yet. Like,
I would take Lore Seeker
because I haven't played it yet. But I don't know that I actually... Like, if I was just... Like, let's say, like, I really had needed to win. I don't know. Yeah.
Well, it's also...
It's right on the line there.
It's like with backup plans, you know it's going to work in every game you play, or with the Soulbinders, you might just never draw it.
Right.
So I might actually take like a backup plan. So I think, once again, hidden agendas, I might not, but...
I just haven't noticed backup plan to be as powerful as I thought it was going to be, because
see, though? Because sometimes they
I've had it a couple times. Yeah, I've had it a couple times, and it's like, I've actually sometimes just chosen the weaker hand with more mana is what I want. I guess that is a choice you're making, but I've just noticed some slow starts and conspiracy aren't punished that hard. So to me, like, backup plan, it's good. Don't get me wrong. It's awesome. But, you know, it, I don't know. I don't know how often I've been like, man, I lost this game because of a slow start or and you don't really want a fast start in general. Like, you don't want to just curve out, and because then everyone's just going to kill you. So what kind of start are you looking for that's so important that you would pass up like a bomb rare like that?
Well, I think it's really interesting. backup plans gets better the more conspiracies you draft, which is might be why I like it so mm-hmm. much. Because if you have a deck full of like hidden agendas, then you want to find the cards that get pumped up
right,
by them.
Right, right, right. Mm-hmm.
So like, for example, say you have, I don't know, like two Courier Hawks or something that are huge with all your hidden agendas. Mm-hmm. You want to make sure you find one in your opening hand so you can play that crazy threat out early. Mm-hmm. So backup plans really compounds all your other conspiracies. It makes them even better.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
So if you're drafting a lot of conspiracies, as I do, I basically... like I almost never pass a conspiracy unless it's for like something I really need for my deck. Then it works out better. Or if backup plan is the only one you have, I mean, it's still strong, but maybe a bomber would be better in your deck.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Interesting.
That's what I love about conspiracy. There's so many different ways you can draft it.
Yeah.
So many different ways. And every time is a fresh experience. So make sure you guys crack a fresh pack
of Magic the Gathering. TM.
TM. Ding.
I oh, needed the ding. Plays. I was going to say the ding too.
Oh,
I don't
nice.
Know why.
Yeah.
So, so being on the team for this set, like, can you tell us a little bit about, like, do any of those cards like spark any memories from you as far as from the design perspective? I don't remember which ones are reprints and which aren't, but I know Whispergear Sneak is definitely not
a
reprint.
Yeah, that's definitely a new one.
Well, I guess I have a couple stories I can tell about cards in this booster pack. I'll talk about the Soulbinders first because was the card we wanted to take. We originally only had... I think we only had one of these cards. Like, there's one of the five. I don't remember which one.
Oh, it wasn't a cycle already.
But it wasn't a cycle. Mm-hmm. And they were just playing so well and so much fun. And it was cool. This was, like, an environment where we could put them, right? They're, like, fit here better than in Commander, I think.
Right.
Uh-huh.
And so we just expanded it out to five, and they all played pretty well. I think, actually, like, the original ones didn't have the second ability that removed counters. They only had, like, the first thing.
They were just a big creature, depending on what other circumstance was.
Yeah, but we wanted to make them a little more special, be a little cooler, you know? Mm-hmm. And so... we tweaked that a little bit. I remember, so cards that were in the file from the very beginning, as far as I can think, were Grudge Keeper. What's the voting guy? Brago's representative.
Brago's representative.
Grudge Keeper and Brago's representative were in there from the very beginning. And I remember when you show somebody the set for the first time, they would read those and they'd just stop. They'd be like, wait, you get an extra vote? What does that even mean?
So the idea of having cards that call votes among the players was in there early on then, if those cards were in.
Yeah, I mean, Sean Main in design had a bunch of different ideas that he was playing around with, but voting was one that he always liked, and I think was there.
It's a great mechanic, and it's one of those mechanics where when you see it, you're like, yeah, why hasn't this been here? But I guess, you know, if you're not developing for multiplayer, then it's not.
Right, in one-on-one games, it's not quite as exciting.
Yeah, not quite as exciting.
Except for what's the one they're using in Legacy to get rid of True Name Nemesis?
Council
Except
Judgment?
For that one, yeah, Council Judgment.
Because you can just sway the vote your way.
You just get to kill something, and it's not targeted, so.
I remember Whispergear Sneak was actually... one of the more controversial ones we made.
Really?
Which might surprise you, but this isn't really talked about much, but something that we really tried to do with a lot of the conspiracies was to make sure that they never affected the nature of draft, like the asynchronous nature. So it was never better to like open one now and play it at another time.
Uh-huh.
Because like, for example, I think an obvious one people would want to make is like reverse the draft, right?
Right, right.
The problem is it really matters when you take that. Like if someone passes their pack, they just get it right back.
Yeah.
Right. So it causes a huge headache.
Right.
And so with Whispergear Sneak, there's definitely some discussion about like, well, you're opening a pack, so like...
does this really affect the sort of the flow and stuff?
Right. And same thing with Lore Seeker, the one that adds an extra booster pack to the draft.
Yeah.
Where it's like, okay, well, the right time to take it is after... if you open it in your opening pack and you want to take it, the quote-unquote right time to take it is after everyone else has already made their pick, so you don't know what you're adding to the draft.
Right, right.
But we eventually decided some level that was okay, and we just had to kind of taper it off.
This actually happened to us when we were waiting in line. We'll get to that story about the line waiting, but... I actually made my pick, passed my pack, and then Kessler took the Aether Searcher. And I was like, crap, because I had passed him like a perfect card for the Aether Searcher. In fact, it was the red version, it's Ignition Team, the red version of Custodial Soulbinders, because I wasn't in red. But if he'd taken the Aether Searcher before I passed my pack, I might have just taken it. So, because there was nothing else in that pack that would have matched up well with the Aether Searcher. And so, you know, I was like, it's exactly what you're talking about. But you know what? That was the fun of the draft. It was like, oh, and for my spiky nature, I was like, oh, remember this in the future to, if you can, wait until they've made their pick before you pass your pack.
Yeah.
You know, that's just a thing you just learn about conspiracy and you can min-max it just like anything else, right?
Well, yeah, and the good news is conspiracy is usually just like a casual fun format.
Right.
So I think if it were like being played at the Pro Tour or something like that, it'd be
if
a
there's like
a
prizes on the line, then it's like totally different.
Yeah.
Right. And then it does get kind of unfortunate because everyone's just staring at each other like waiting to pass the pack.
Yeah.
And everyone knows
like,
what's going
on. They'd probably have to put it on a clock or something. Like, I don't even know what they'd do.
It's like, did any of you guys ever draft Innistrad Block?
Yeah, I did.
So Innistrad Block had these double face cards in them, and the draft rule was you could see what everyone else's was at the table.
Right.
And there would occasionally be these weird situations where, like, say I open Bloodline Keeper, which is a black bomb rare. Mm-hmm. And Josh, who's to my right, opens Bloodline Keeper, which is a black bomb rare. And he just, you know, and like, we're looking at our packs, and I just slam mine before he slams his. I'm like, look, I'm taking this. You can take yours if you want, but I'm going to be in black because I'm going to play this card.
Oh, right. Because they can clearly see it. Yeah.
Right. And there's this really awkward thing that happens there. And some players liked that. Some players disliked it. But it was definitely a strange element to draft. We try not to put in too often. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, I think it's fine because you can build strategies around that just like anything else. It's just like, well, some people just don't like anything yeah. that's
And you're looking for hints
general,
anyway and things to push you.
I think difference is good. Variety is good. Like having to change that kind of thought process. You know, again, not every time, but sometimes, yeah, that's
Keeps
good.
You on your toes.
Yeah.
Magic's an always changing game, and we try and make sure that every set is something new and exciting to offer.
Yeah.
So we should tell the story, since we alluded to it, about our yes. fun experience here at Comic-Con, because if you don't know, there's a special promo pack mm-hmm. that Wizards releases at Comic-Con. They've done it for
2 years now. This is the second year.
This is the second year.
Yep.
And what they are is it's every Planeswalker from the current core set, so M15, and it is these awesome like black foil
alternate art
versions, and they have like little splashes of the color, like Jace has a little like blue fire coming from his hand or something, yeah. and they just look sick. And the problem is they're like super limited.
Yep. You have to wait in line to get them.
And
hey, you can't forget you're also getting a giant Nerf Garrick battle axe.
Oh yeah, I forgot about the huge Nerf battle axe.
How
yeah.
could you? It's the majority of the packaging,
which is actually totally sweet.
It is. Gotta hold it.
It's like, huge too.
It's huge. It is like a primo toy. If I was a kid and I had this, I would have gone nuts. But I'm an adult and I have it, and I'm still pretty excited.
You're still a kid, actually.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure. So anyway, so we get to the convention center at about 1 a.m.
Yep.
to wait in line for these things, which are basically being released the next morning. Mm-hmm. So we already know we're gonna wait through the entire night. And by the way, there's already what, 5,000 people in line ahead of us? Like,
yeah, there's a bunch of people in line.
There was a lot.
And one too. It's like we weren't even waiting for Hall H or like one of those big like convention halls. We were just trying to buy stuff.
Yeah, I don't know if all those 5,000 or whatever, that's just a number I made up, people in line were waiting for specifically the same
Most
line we
were,
but
it seemed like they wanted to buy something from Hasbro or the Magic line, which is like, it made sense. It was a sweet, sweet item.
So Jimmy and I, being the crazy hardcore, well, just the crazy people that we are, we had been in communication beforehand, like gathering all these supplies. So we show up and we have a table, we've got chairs. We're like, well, if we're going to be here all night, let's just draft the whole time.
Just draft, yeah.
So we're the only people in the line. Gavin's there.
Yeah, and I was impressed by their dedication. I've done a lot of line waiting in the past 2 years at Comic-Con, but I've never seen a full-on table with chairs around it. And it felt like we were the sultans of the line.
Yeah.
We just sat on our lofty thrones drafting booster packs.
Yeah.
And I'm sure mini humans around people, around us, were just like, what are they doing and why are they making so much noise?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, because of course you're drafting, so you're like, oh, God, I want this, but do I want that? You know,
yeah.
We're just being loud. Then who came over? There was a couple guys like that were ex-Pro Tour guys and they're judges now? Or
two of my friends came over who I knew from Pro Tour days, and they were like, you guys drafting Magic? Let's play.
Yeah.
Which is great. It's cool that Magic lets you do that, right?
Yeah, yeah, and they were our line
buddies. And they
just
sat down
and
were like, yeah. And they were our line buddies the whole night.
I remember last year I stood in a line that lasted all night, too. And it wasn't even a Magic line or anything, but I just wandered the line and found some people playing Commander.
Uh-huh. Oh, nice.
And I just sat down and they're like, here's the deck, let's play. And we had a blast. And in fact, we stayed in touch. And when I came back to
Did they know who you were when you sat down?
They did not know who I was when I sat down.
but they sure did when
awesome.
I stood up.
That's true.
did their eyes light up like, holy crap, this guy makes the game?
Well, this is like a very guilty pleasure of mine, but something I always enjoy is like, I don't like to boast about like what I do or anything like that. So I'm happy just to go into a situation and be like, oh, we're all Magic players. Let's play. Because I want to see how they're going to treat me just as like a regular person.
Yeah.
So but there's always this moment, which I do get a little bit of glee out of, when like they're like, oh, what do you do? And we're like halfway through a game of Magic. I'm like, oh, I make Magic cards. And they're just like, look at you. They look at each other. They look back at you.
Like he's kidding, right? You what?
Yeah, that's a good moment. That's a good moment.
Yesterday I was talking
to... It's like that card you're playing? I made it.
yeah. Or I'll slip that in sometimes too. Though. I don't get to play in tournaments very often because I can't, working for Wizards. But there was a charity tournament a few weeks ago that I was allowed to play in, and because it was unsanctioned. And I'm playing against this guy who just has no idea that I make Magic. And he beats me with Obsidat Ghost Council in the first game.
Nice.
And afterwards, I'm shuffling up for game two, and I'm like, man, losing to a card that you made has this like awkward little twist to it.
Come on, you can be like sort of proud at the same time.
Yeah,
that
right?
You're disappointed.
You can't get too angry about that.
That's like the other night we played, and then we switched decks just for fun. And I was like, either way, I win here, because if you beat me with my deck, I feel good. And if I beat you with your deck, then at least I won.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm always a fan of setting up those all-win scenarios. So.
Yeah, all-win scenarios, not a bad thing, because you're mostly losing in Magic. Or at least when I play, I'm mostly losing.
I don't know what you're talking about, Jimmy.
You know, an underrated part of that night in line is where we draft a conspiracy. Or no, this is before. We're playing a commander before we draft conspiracy, and Jimmy and I are on one side of the table, and on the other side of the table, Matt Arnold, who works at Rocket Jump, he's one of the creators of VGHS. I look him in the eye, and he looks at me and just shakes his head and looks at the round of the table, and I notice like he's playing with you, Gavin. He's playing with Kessler, who plays at like GPs and has you know, gotten top eights or whatever he's done, and then one of those your friends that you know from the pro tour. So he's like, how did I get stuck in this like rogues gallery of pro players?
Matt, who only started playing 4 months ago,
I'm gonna get killed. Why am I sitting over here?
I did, in fact, kill him.
That's what you do. That's how you learn, right?
Yep.
I think I believe my my play that game was turn one Sol Ring, turn two Phyrexian Metamorph Sol Ring.
Ramp.
That's okay.
Yeah.
It's all right.
It's pretty all right. So let's actually get to talking about all the amazing announcements that you guys made this year.
Dun, dun, dun.
Yeah, it was an awesome panel. People were there. We got there at like 10 a.m. and you could tell that everyone around us wasn't there for anything else. They were just waiting for the Wizards panel to start. So I'm happy for
it. There was a lot of cheering, a lot of like people were really excited. Great. It was pretty awesome.
And one of the big things was from the Vault Annihilation. And you are one of the developers on 20, correct?
Yeah, so I'm the designer of From the Vault. Right. So starting with From the Vault 20, I took it over, and I made From the Vault 20 and From the Vault Annihilation and a few things you guys haven't seen yet.
Some sweet codename things in the future.
Actually, this entire From the Vault is very Commander, because, I mean, I don't have statistics on hand, but I'm just gonna go ahead and say, like, in EDH, more board sweepers are played than probably any other format. Like, it's just it's a staple of the format. Like, just because you're playing against four other people or three other people, like, you're just always like, I just want to kill everything.
Yeah. Okay. I'm behind.
Just kill everything. Let's just kill everything. So, you know, this is going to be something I think that every EDH player is going to want to at least take a look at.
Yeah. And I don't think Red has many board wipes either.
Yeah. It has a lot of, you know, it's got some crazy ones like Apocalypse, which blows everything up.
Right.
Creed
right.
Annihilation. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't have a ton. Rolling Earthquake is really interesting too, in that normally Red can't kill flyers very well
with
its sweepers, like Earthquake, for example. And this one does. I mean, in From the Vault, I always try and put in cards that are highly sought after or like hard to acquire. And there's no real reason why this card should be as hard to get as it is, except for the fact it was in Portal 3 Kingdoms, which was a really limited card
limited
set.
Yeah, in general.
And so it's a great way to get more of those out there and to get a unique card in people's hands. I mean, at one point, I even saw Legacy play and you just couldn't find them because they were so hard to get a hold of. And now this will just get more out there. You can put it in Commander, you can try it out in Legacy, you know, play it in your casual decks, whatever you want
to do. It's really great because it's so hard to get a hold of, and it'll be totally useful, especially to mono red players.
Going in my mono red.
Yeah, exactly. So for sure. Thank you, Gavin.
Just watch out for those creatures with horsemanship, man. They're going to get you.
Yeah, they are going to get you.
Maybe it'll change the EDH meta where everybody will, no, that won't happen.
Everyone's finding
what else we got? We had Wrath of God, classic. Cataclysm was in there.
Living Death as well.
Yeah. And then, one of my personal favorites, and everybody loves this card, Armageddon.
Yeah, Armageddon is a great way to make friends for never.
That was sarcasm for the sarcastically impaired.
It's... Few things are more brutal than just like creature, blow up all your lands. Just you work so hard for it. And this is the kind of thing we just never do these days. But back in the early days of Magic, we did some crazy stuff. It's an iconic sweeper. And, you know, I really felt like if you're going to have a box of sweepers, Wrath and Armageddon.
They're the original Gruesome Twosome. Back when I started playing, which was basically at the start, like, Armageddon, it was not a big deal. Like, people just did it all the time. So you didn't, like, now it's like you play an Armageddon and the whole table will, like, slowly turn towards you and glare at you.
Yeah.
And then go up. And then
go like,
I'll
let's
try
kill
and kill you. Yeah.
I can't. I don't have any lands.
I can't cast stuff.
Next game, though.
It's so funny that back in the day, there was this deck called Urnamageddon. I don't know if you guys are familiar with this. It was a deck that used Armageddon with this Urnam Jin guy, who was like a 4/5 creature that gave your opponent's creatures forest walk. And everyone for the longest time was like, oh man, Urnam Jin is so powerful. Like, it was using this crazy deck back in the day. And then we reprinted it and it did absolutely nothing. And people were like, oh yeah, I guess it was the destroying all the lands.
It was
part
mostly
of that thing.
Armageddon that was powerful, yeah.
And Wrath of God, if you haven't seen the From the Vault version, we showed it off a couple months ago, but it's got totally awesome new artwork.
Yeah,
it shows
all the art and is amazing in this.
the thing I love about Wrath of God is it shows a literal god from Theros, Heliod, blowing stuff up. It is literally the wrath of a god, which I thought was pretty really sick. Awesome.
Yeah. Heliod's a bad dude. His I like how the story's gone for the Theros block, and Heliod is not everyone's favorite guy. So it's apt that he's blowing it all up. Oh,
poor Elspeth.
Poor Elspeth. She'll rise again potentially. Who knows?
Something I always try and do in front of the vault is make sure that all the colors are represented. Right. I never want to, you know, be like, okay, here's this box, which is only good if you play one color. Right. Like, even if I were to do something where it was like really focused on a theme, I would try and get cards from all kinds of different colors to mm-hmm. represent it, you mm-hmm. know? So there might be exceptions to that in the future, but I definitely try and represent as much as possible.
I mean, I think this is an auto buy for me just because
it's a staple for anybody who plays EDH. Yeah, I think you're going to be able to use all these cards.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's awesome for Commander, and also if you're a cube player too, there's so many great cards in there.
Yep.
Like Rolling Earthquake is a card, once again, that's really hard to get, but it's an awesome cube card. Like it's Earthquake and it kills off flyers and it just gives you some more variety to play with.
Yeah.
But it's just so hard to get, and now you can finally have the chance to put one in your cube and make it all foil and new card frame.
Plus it's going to be shiny.
You can't deny the all foil and the new card format and the border and everything.
Yeah.
That was pretty exciting. I do like what's been done with the border. I think it makes the card pop. I like how you have a lot more room on the bottom for, you know, artist name and number and all that stuff. So I'm a big fan.
There's a brief moment where all the cards just look like planeswalkers to me with the new card frame, but now I'm just so used to it. Like, I mean, I haven't actually been playing with the new card frame much longer than you guys have because we play with like playtest cards that don't have the frame on them. But the transition was so fast. It took like a day or two, and then very quickly I was just used to it. Now it's actually kind of off-putting when I combine cards of the two different borders, just because I want all my cards to look like the new frame. It looks so good.
The new frame to me looks like when plasma TVs first came out, and they're just like sleek and they're just like sharp and they're just glossy and they just pop good. And like then when you look like in an old tube TV, you're like, how do we think that looked good for so long?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so, yeah, I really like
the new borders. Well, it was the only thing we had. We didn't know what we had until we got something better.
Exactly. Right. In 20 years, when we're all having, like, TV beamed into our heads, we'll be like, how did everyone ever watch television?
Yeah, what? And also, like, why did we ever drive our own cars? That's going to be a legitimate question.
But we'll still be playing Magic.
Yeah. I hope so.
That's my goal.
I seriously do hope to open a box of Conspiracy when I'm like 50 years old and be like, guys, let's do it. And people will be like, oh my gosh, this is
we got to slow down on drafting it then because I'm running out of boxes of it.
Oh, that means you just got to buy more.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Josh, why don't you go buy more booster packs?
All right, let's move on. There are a couple of other fun announcements. The Duel Decks Anthology, I think, is great. That's a great way, again, to get cards that are just not around anymore because if it was a print run in the past. The Divine versus Demonic deck, I know for sure, has a couple of staples in there for a lot of EDH decks as well. So I'm really excited about that, which is sweet.
Yeah, I mean, the original Duel Decks are a ton of fun to play. If you guys out there have never had a chance to play them, and I'm really happy we get to release them again because they're just hard to find. They were made several years ago, and now you can finally get your hands on some and play them. And plus, I always enjoy combining the Duel Decks in strange ways. Yeah. Like, I love seeing like Jace versus Garrick or whatever, you know?
Yeah.
When I go Spell Sling at like tournaments, like pre-releases or whatever, I'll often bring a box just has all the Duel Decks, and we'll be like, if you don't have a deck to play, that's great. Just pick one. I'll pick one. We'll play.
Yeah,
that's
cool. I think it's honestly one of the best ways to teach someone how to play the game because it had two decks that are meant to face off against each other, and even if they're not meant to, you can use two different ones. But it's like they've got all the core elements of how to play, and it's very thematic. It's very flavorful for like elves versus goblins. It's just that's great. You never see that matchup really anywhere else.
Yeah, I mean, they're a little complex for some players, but once you have like the very basic grasp of Magic, it's an awesome play to dive right in. It's like, okay, I learn about all these cool mechanics, all these cool rares, right? Play some spicy cards.
Let's talk about something past the Duel Decks that I think is very exciting, and it's Commander 2014.
Oh, yes. Very exciting.
And the big
super exciting, actually.
Yeah, if you
holy
guys
crap.
Haven't heard, is a mono-colored Commander decks for 2014, and a Planeswalker can be your Commander. We have Teferi, Temporal Archmage, and he is awesome. I mean, this card looks great. And it says at the bottom, Teferi, Temporal Archmage can be your commander. Words you have never seen ever.
I mean, the door that this opens is like, it opens into like the end of Raiders of the Lost Ark when they're pushing the Ark of the Covenant into that huge warehouse. Like, that's the door that it opened. Hold on, I want to read them just in case people out there haven't heard. Teferi, Temporal Archmage, he costs 4 and 2 blue, so 6 total. He's a Planeswalker. His plus one ability is look at the top two cards of your library, put one of them into your hand and the other on the bottom of your library. His negative one ability is untap up to 4 target permanents.
Permanents. Ooh.
Not just yours. And his negative 10, his ultimate, is you get an emblem with You may activate loyalty abilities of planeswalkers you control on any player's turn anytime you could cast an instant. And he starts with 5 loyalty, I should say. So you'd have to plus 1 and 5 times to fire off his ultimate.
Yeah.
Which is, this is kind of in a theme we've been seeing lately with things that affect the loyalty.
Right.
Either like counters or usage, chain veil and Ajani. The new Ajani does that. So it looks like, I mean, I don't want you to have to give anything away, but it looks like we're sort of moving into the realm of like making your planeswalker sort of work more in concert together.
Super friends.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting. So planeswalkers, out of all the different card types, are some of the most limited design space.
Right.
Just because they're really hard to get right. Like, we spend more time developing planeswalkers than basically any other card, and there's only so much you can do with them. Mm-hmm. So we're always very careful to like kind of conserve it. And, you know, we haven't really done a lot with that in the past. So, you know, we've done a couple cards like that now, and maybe there'll be some more in the future. So, and I think, you know, it's a cool place to explore.
Yeah,
it definitely does seem like the ultimate, especially, is seems like the sort of thing that you can sort of break in something, a format like EDH, where, you know, a lot of the earlier planeswalkers are not designed to have their stuff. Yeah. It's a something that changes the basic design of all the planeswalkers that come before, where they weren't designed for that ability to be able to be used as an instant.
Speed, yeah.
And so, like, yeah, that's some place to start looking for ways to sort of break the or abuse, as we like to do in EDH. You know,
and
that,
if you
you're
do
looking for
manage to
infinite
get this
combos
happen,
and stuff like that.
Yeah, this, if you make this happen, I want to see a picture of the table, because that's going to be ridiculous. I mean, I feel like the biggest target on your back is when you're like, I'm at 7 loyalty counters, and everyone's like, wait, no, this can't happen. This can't happen at all.
Yeah, that's it's going to be hard to pull off anywhere just because it's 10, but, you know,
yeah,
it's Commander. You're going to be able to make it happen sometimes.
Yeah, well, just like Commander is full of crazy dreams and fantasies you get to kind of unleash, and what better place to doubling season Teferi than here? You're probably not going to do it anywhere else, you know?
So. Yeah, exactly. It's yeah, one of the few times. And they're all mono-colored decks, which I think is really exciting.
Yeah, so every Commander deck is mono-colored. I have to ask, can you tell us anything about the other generals? The other decks? Anything?
I wish I could. I really wish I could, but I will say that they're definitely exciting. I mean, what we said yesterday is many of the legends and in this Commander set are throughout Magic's history, and there's some cool references in there. So I think
is this the only Planeswalker that can be a Commander, or are we maybe gonna get?
It's a cycle of monocolored Planeswalkers. So it'll be one for each deck.
Ooh!
So everyone is a Planeswalker as Commander.
Every deck has at least one Planeswalker that could be used as Commander.
It's going to be sitting in the front.
I guess, is each one going to have, as they usually do, like a couple other legendary creatures that you could use as the front man for the deck? Or
yeah, we always like to make sure to include some variety. And especially with monocolored decks, it makes it a little easier because, you know, in the past, you have to make, if you want to, say, have a three-color deck, maybe you need like multiple three-color legends to make it work. There's also going to be a cycle of legendary creatures that have never really got a card before. So, for example, we saw Giza at the panel.
Oh, yeah.
And she's, you know, was awesome in Innistrad, but never had the chance to get a card. And she's finally being realized here, and you'll get a couple other cool options.
So
like that
every
as well.
Other color has one legendary creature like
legendary
that.
Legendary creature, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And you'll have to wait to see what they are, but there are some cool ones in there.
We will wait with bated breath.
Yeah. I'm excited for Ghoul-Caller Giza. I can actually see lots of decks that could just abuse the crap out of that.
Oh, she's super powerful. I mean, the fact you can even sacrifice a zombie if you need to make two more zombies just lets you split them over and over. So.
Yeah, so, yeah, that's
bar zombie broken. Engine. Zombie coil engine. Thanks to
zombie
thanks
coil
to
engine.
Ghoul-Caller Giza.
You can sacrifice defenders. This is great. Have a lot of power. So.
That's true.
But there's a lot of cool stuff in it. And I'm excited about the monocolor theme. I mean, once we decided we were going to do Commander every single year, we wanted to make sure that we could do it in different ways, you know? And so monocolor was something we knew we were going to get to eventually, and here we are.
I was really excited to see that because, you know, now I can mix and match a little bit too. Like, it's harder to mix and match almost when you have, like, multicolor pre-made decks because a lot of the cards are going to be gold and I can't take those from one to the other. But now, like, any blue deck, I can use all the cards. If it just has some blue in it, all these cards are up for grabs in that deck. And so I really like that. I think it's a good idea.
Well, and sometimes it helps deck building just to narrow your possibilities, which I know sounds kind of lame, but especially if you're newer at Commander, it's like, man, I have to build a Commander deck. I'm like three colors. How am I supposed to figure out what cards go in here? And if you're mono blue, it's like, okay, I can put all my cool blue cards in here.
Right.
Yeah.
And I mean, I, as big Commander players, I'm sure you guys know the pain as much as anybody of having to cut cards from your Commander deck. You lay it at the table and look over it like a sergeant overlooking his plans trying to figure out like the one thing you can change.
Yeah. I like the idea of mono decks just because it's like you actually don't see that very often when you play Commander, right? You're always looking at two or three color commanders. Very rarely do you see a monocolor deck. And I think people sometimes view it as potentially just being too weak to other decks specifically. And I like this idea because it's going to open the meta up a little more. It's going to push boundaries. It's going to make people actually, you know, play with monocolored decks and make it be a force to be reckoned with.
One of the goals we have for the show, and I'm sure Wizards has, is like introducing new players and getting more players into the space and to try out. And you know, Commander can be an entry point for that. And like monocolor is just a little bit easier to play because the interactions aren't going to be quite as complex. Yeah. And like you said, like instead of having 100% of all Magic cards available to you, you've got 20%. And that just makes it a lot easier to dive in and be playing faster. And from there, you can build out and make a two-color deck and three-color deck. So it's a better entry point, I think, for new players, which is great because we just want more people to be playing the game and to be learning like how awesome it is, and you know, so that Wizards can stay successful and vibrant, and they can keep making risky choices, like making things like Conspiracy, and like that's good for every player. So you know,
yeah.
So this is a good way of like, hey, your friend, he's been watching you play. We all have that friend who sort of comes over, asks questions, looks over your shoulder, hasn't actually played. Monocolored Commander deck is a great way to be like, hey, dude, this is your chance to sort of jump in on a more simplified level, maybe.
And you can
start trying out the game.
A really solid tribal deck in the monocolored, like mono blue.
Oh, yeah, goblins, elves,
merfolk. There's just so many options. Yeah.
So there's just a lot of, the space for you to have fun as a Johnny is not a Johnny, as a Johnny is still huge. Like, it's still, like, wide and varied, and it's not like it's cutting you off in any way, you know, where different than two colors or three colors. Like, yeah, but it can be more simplified for people that are new to the game. So, no, I just think it's awesome. It's great. I hope next year maybe we're going to see four-color commanders, though.
Who knows?
Who knows, right?
Maybe we will. Maybe we won't. You heard it here first,
may
people.
Not.
Right. As Rosewater likes to say, there's always a chance.
There's always a chance.
I don't even want the information. I just want to plug it. I know you guys have heard it plenty.
There doesn't seem like there's too much more we can talk about Commander without going into the super spoiler reveal-y that we can't even get into. But I'm really excited. I think the Commander products, Wizards has done a great job every year just because it's like it feeds a growing market and it changes it up.
Well, that's interesting. Gavin, can you talk a little bit about, because in recent years, we've really seen Wizards sort of like notice us as the multiplayer, you know, I feel like one of the reasons we started the show is because like 90% of all like coverage online or anywhere is by ex-pros or pros about tournament style Magic, and which is great, don't get me wrong, but 90% of people play the game like we do, which is like at their kitchen table at home, and you know, I feel like Wizards has sort of taken notice of that whole large aspect more in the design realm as far as like pushing multiplayer stuff more. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, we definitely saw Commander boom. I mean, and people love it. There's for a long time in Magic, multiplayer meant so many different things. It could mean like bring out your 60 card singleton deck. Mm-hmm. It could mean like your 100 card singleton deck. It could be, you know, an 8-player Emperor game or something crazy like that. Mm-hmm. And something awesome that Commander has done is really give a unified language to multiplayer. Mm-hmm. There's still a lot of other ways to play, of course. I think Conspiracy is a great example of that. But the fact that the majority of multiplayer big deck Magic right now is being played as Commander lets us hone in and make cards that are good for that. Like when we make a Commander product, we can make sure we're putting stuff in there that's going to be good for most multiplayer play groups. And I'm really excited we have that opportunity and that it's been received so well by players that we can do that every single year and create stuff.
Yeah, because right, you release like a Commander official product. It hasn't been officially endorsed by Wizards yet. Let's say we're back a couple of years. It's like there is a chance that the community would just reject it. Just outright be like, no, this is all wrong. This is, you know, like this, I don't like this or this or this. But I feel like they've done such a smooth job and great job transitioning into it that it's become like a widely just like, sweet, awesome, more stuff coming out supporting this. And, you know, for anyone wanting to jump in, I think that's the most important point. It's like, because it's cool. Like all these people with tons of cards in their library, like I'm just going to make a sweet Commander deck because I have one of all these awesome cards. Someone that doesn't have a point to jump in, Commander decks are an excellent place to start for anyone.
Yeah, and you're going to be playing with a group of friends, and we've talked about it before, Commander EDH is a great format in that like the best cards don't always win. So like you can grab one of these things off the shelf, and oftentimes we've seen them win games with like guys that have like alpha and beta cards, because all you got to do is like convince everybody else to attack that guy, and then you don't have to worry about him so much. Like there's, because of the political aspect of the game, like your individual card quality as far as like how bomb rare each one is or what set they come from is not quite as important, which I think appeals to a lot of people who, you know, we don't have every card that's ever come out. Like, that's just, most people just don't.
Multiplayer is a great self-policing format, right? Yeah. If you're the guy who's blowing everyone's stuff up, people are going to try and kill you. And if you're the dude who bought a commander deck and is maybe new to it, and, you know, maybe your deck isn't quite as crazy as some other people's, maybe they'll leave you alive for a little bit longer.
Right, exactly. Yeah. They probably will. They probably will.
There's no reason to, like, you know, like, you're not a threat. And I'm making an ally. If you attack you, you can be on my side when it comes down to it.
And by the way, like, if you bring your friend in to play Commander for the first time, like, let them have a good experience the first few times. You want them to keep playing, right? Don't just Armageddon them, like, the very first game. Like, maybe, because it's like you can shear a sheep many times, but you can skin him only once.
Ah.
Yeah.
So are we collecting the fur of our friends? Huh? Am I going to make, like, a sweet sweater off of the sheared sheep wool?
Yeah, one of those sweet Christmas sweaters.
Stay warm at your commander.
So I guess what I just learned is when you buy your From the Vault Annihilation, shear the Armageddon. I'm not sure what the story is there.
Just hide it. Be like, yeah, it only came with 14 cards this time. I don't know what happened.
Just wait to unleash it on your friends who are just looting commander until like their fourth or fifth game. That's all. And then just destroy their lands every single game.
Every game, yeah. Just because. Just for fun.
You know, do you play EDH?
Yeah, I definitely play Commander. I have a few different decks and one that I favor. So,
what's your favorite deck and who's the commander?
I play probably most of my Mariki Rebarit deck, which is a white, blue, black, and Esper deck.
Ooh, nice.
And it just contains a lot of my favorite cards from throughout Magic. Something I love about Commander is that you get to show off all the cards you love and that you've collected over the years, right? Mm-hmm. And so I can put some really cool cards in there, you know, like my foil Texas Cryptic Commands, you know, all kinds of promos and my dual lands and whatever. And I get to just play with my favorite cards. And really, when I go to play Commander, what I'm looking to is to have fun, and for me what's fun is playing with some of my favorite cards in Magic.
Right, absolutely. And you're opened up to the whole world of, actually, what is your favorite card? Do you have some?
My favorite card ever in the history of a Magic kind. My favorite card, and one I will usually give as an answer, is Revelark, if you guys are familiar with that card at all. I love it because it's good in so many different ways. Like, you can do a lot of stuff with it, and it's so open-ended. Like, every time we make new Magic cards, there are maybe new creatures you can bring back with it. Mm-hmm. And I played it a ton. I mean, I have a soft spot for a lot of other really spiky cards, but Revelark is one that just, like, kind of hits the Johnny spike, and even some Timmy in there, too. I mean, Spellsetter Sprite will always have a special place in my heart. It qualified me for like 4 Pro Tours in 4 different formats.
Wow. So that definitely has a special place then. That card did work.
Yeah, I've got my lucky play set of 4 Spellsetter Sprites in 4 different decks.
Nice. It worked. Nice. How about you, Jimmy? What's your favorite card in Magic history? I've never asked you this.
It's true. It was probably one of the first cards I ever played, and it was Lightning Bolt.
Yeah.
Because I had that and like a Fireball and like Incinerate in my first ever Magic deck when I was in third grade.
You were Jimmy the Red from the movie.
I was so much fun because I was like, haha, I kill you. That was like, I was super Timmying out back then in the day because I was like, I didn't have, you know, back then it was like Nightmare was like the hot card. You know, everyone had to have a Nightmare and right. A Sarah Angel.
Broken.
Yeah, super broken. That Shivan Dragon, man, that thing was powerful.
Broken.
It's a dragon. I think Lightning Bolt, just for its sheer efficiency and it you can use it in any format, any time, and it does work. It'll always do work for you.
I got to go with Counterspell.
Counterspell? Yeah.
Safe bet.
Man, answers anything. Bet. Anytime you got a Counterspell in your hand, you're like, I'm going to use this. It's going to be awesome. I don't know when, but it's going
to
be awesome.
Yeah.
I will say one of my favorite cards to cast in all of Magic is definitely Mana Tithe, which is a 1-mana 4 spike in white from Planar Chaos. And I enjoy it so much because they never see it coming.
Yeah.
And you only have to teach them that lesson once. And it's like, you know, give a man, cast a Mana Tithe once, keep a man happy or keep a man sad for a game, show him a Mana Tithe and counter is like, bomb, he'll be play around for the rest of his life, that kind of thing. I don't know.
That's true. I feel like that happens in Commander too. It's like if you're playing a certain deck against someone, you only have to do one thing once and then you're like, oh God, this is going to...
They give you credit for having it in your hand like all the time after that. Yeah.
Yeah.
And in Cube, I'm just constantly terrified. Like, I know I have to play into it because they're not going to have it most of the time. But the 5%, they're like Mana Tithe, your sweet spell. Thing ever. It's like, where did that even come from? You know?
Yeah.
there was a draft. So Brian Wong, who's on Limited Resources,
right.
A longtime friend of mine. We've played Magic forever. And we're playing a Cube draft and we're doing a team Cube draft. So normally, we do like 3-on-3 teams.
Uh-huh.
And, Brian asked John Laux, his teammate, and they were talking, and John's playing this match. And John's like, Brian, does he have four spike in his deck? And Brian's like, oh, no, don't worry about it. And then the guy just mana tides him. Oh. Brian's like, oh, right, he had mana tide.
So, well, he did make the right choice.
He was technically right. No, yeah, Brian was technically right. Yeah, he did not have four spike.
And technically correct is the most important kind of correct.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly. Yeah, cards that come out of nowhere, it's like Commander's great until you see someone that's holding up two blue mana. Then Commander becomes ass turn.
Well, it's tricky because someone's got to break that counter spell.
Yep.
But no one wants to be the first person to have their spell countered. You know?
Yeah, exactly.
It's better to just be the person with the counter spell.
Yeah. And the worst part is having to bait the counter spell sometimes with just a less powerful card, but then that doesn't get countered. It's like, oh, I didn't even want to play that this turn. I tried, guys. I tried.
In Commander, I find that a lot of the time I bait counter spells with my Commander just because it'll always go back into exile.
Yeah.
Right.
So it's like, okay, I didn't actually spend a card on doing anything.
Yeah.
And a lot of times they won't even counter it because it's not going to get them ahead that far. You
mm-hmm.
know?
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah. It's true. Yeah. That's actually a good call. Like, here comes my big scary Commander, everybody. Ah, oh, great.
Here comes the card you know I've had since we started the game.
Pretty much.
It sucks countering a Commander, yeah, because you're basically one for nothing yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
At least it's not getting hindered, getting tucked away.
Right. Sometimes you just have to do it. I mean, if Prosh is going to come out and literally, and Perforce is on the table and literally just kill everybody, then you just have to do it.
Yeah, but it's got to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, Commander. A game of many stories, I think, is how I describe it.
Do you have a favorite Commander story, Gavin, before we go?
We've got, this is a kind of silly story, but so every now and then I'll get flown somewhere to go spell slinging,
uh-huh.
and I'll bring my Commander deck, because obviously people want to play Commander, and we usually end up playing one-on-one Commander, which is just because, you know, there's one of them and one of me, so it's a good number.
Yeah.
And I was playing my Mariki Rabaret deck, and I play Mariki Rabaret on my third turn, and he has like this insane start. He's playing like an artifact deck, and he played Master Transmuter, which allows him to return artifact to his hand put into play. And he like triumphantly is like, Blightsteel Colossus, your turn. I'm like, all right, steal it, kill you.
Think of that.
And he was like, oh.
Oh, yeah.
That's interesting.
He's like, that. I should have seen that coming.
Blightsteel, literally the worst thing to play against that deck. Yeah, they could just steal your stuff.
It's funny because like he did it, and I was like, oh no, is it like Lightning Greaves? What's happening now? Am I just dead? And then he just passed the turn, and I was like, oh,
is this going to happen?
Is this real life? You
That's
know?
Pretty funny.
What's yours is now mine. Yeah, I think the sudden turnarounds Commander are definitely some of my favorites. At least someone being so dominant, everyone being like, crap, we're going to lose again. And then someone else just busting out of nowhere, just ruining their well-laid plans because they didn't see it coming. Always a good time. Sweet revenge or vengeance, retribution.
The thing about Commander is, I mean, you'll usually play a lot of games with the same play group, so sometimes you can be pretty spiteful from week to week.
Oh, yeah. So let's talk. The big announcement, obviously, of the panel was all the Khans of Tarkir stuff. And I think the biggest one that I'm sure you're very excited about is the wedges and the fact that you can actually refer to them by name now.
Oh, I'm so excited. It has been so hard to not call them by their names.
And just the colors.
And I have been terrified for like a year that I was going to like put in an article somewhere or something. So every article I would like, you know, look through and make sure I didn't do it.
Right.
And it's great to finally have things to call these because we've had the shards, you know, for years now.
Right. And if you don't know what the shards are, you may have heard their names before, like Bant, Esper, Grixis. There are three combinations of colors that came out in Shards of Alara, and they're the allied colors.
It's just like two color guilds from Ravnica, Zoria, mm-hmm. Celestia have a name. So every color combination has a name if it's in two colors. Until now, we haven't had for all the three color pairings. Do we have them all now?
We have them all now. Yeah. So the way to kind of think about it is we refer to them as kind of shards or wedges. So if you look at the back of a Magic card, this is an easy way to do it.
Huh.
You can just look at the three colors next to each other are all allied colors. So they're all a shard. So if like I just pick white for whatever reason, I'm like, okay, white and green and blue. That's a shard. So that's mm-hmm. Bant. What we're doing in Khans of Tarkir is looking at the wedges, which are the clans, which contain an enemy color. So you pick two colors that are next to each other, like say green and white, and then you pick their naturally enemy. You pick their natural enemy, which is black. Mm-hmm. So like green, white, and black is Obzon. So
And it looks like a wedge because it's a triangle across the five.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. how they got their names. In fact, I predict that by the time Khans of Tarkir block is over, they will not be called wedges anymore. We'll just call them clans. Kind of like how shards were actually originally called arcs, but now they're never called that anymore.
Right.
And kind of like guilds are called guilds. And
right. Yeah.
So just to go through the wedges, there's Obzon, there's Jeskai, there's Sultai, there's Mardu, and there's, how do you pronounce it? Temur?
Temur, yep.
Temur.
Like a femur, but with a T.
And by now, there's
You can share that with the whole company.
You're patenting that?
That's actually the tagline for the set. I don't know if you're familiar.
Like femur, but with a T.
Yeah, if you play Temur at the pre-release, that's what it says on the pre-release box.
Yeah, just get around and chant. We want teamers, not femurs.
So first question I have about this, Wedge is super exciting. This is going to be awesome. How did you guys go about coming up with the names for each? I know people are like thinking like, oh, it's going to be hard. I've seen a lot of tweets already. I was like, how are we going to like remember these names?
I'll tell you, but, I remember them. You'll remember them by just playing it.
Well, it's amazing. Like
name
we didn't
over like a like, month or two.
It didn't take very long to start calling it Grixis or Azorius or whatever you're calling it. So I don't, this isn't not going to be any different, but as far as like from the, from conception, like naming each thing, like how does the names come about?
Yeah
So I talked about design and development earlier, and also inside R&D we have another process which is called the creative team, and those are the guys who put flavor text on cards, make all the awesome artwork, give them cool names, and one of their jobs every set is to do a bunch of world building and figure out what the names of everything is. And I know for the clans they spent a ton of time getting these names right because they're going to stick as part of Magic forever.
Yeah, exactly, right? This is what we're going to call this three color combination forever.
And I remember, I mean, there are all kinds of other names that were looked at, and every like month it seemed like maybe like one letter would change and they would try out something new. But eventually they settled on ones that they really liked a lot.
You know, do they worry about more about how it sounds when you say it or more about how it looks when you read it? Because those are two very different things.
I think they're really looking for the whole package because magic is expressed in so many ways, right? You're going to type it a lot and you're going to read it a lot, but you're also going to say it a lot. And we don't want to give you a word that is just impossible to say.
I also like the names too because it's like it's very important to be able to look at a name and pronounce it quote unquote correctly, or at least be able to read it just off the page. So like all these names like Abzan, Abzan, Jeskai, like there are not too many like weird alternate pronunciations. And I remember like the first time I saw Phyrexian and I had no idea what that word was. Like, this doesn't make any sense. But then I looked at it for a few more seconds, like, oh, Phyrexian. Okay, yeah. This word has entered my lexicon of words from Magic, and it just becomes a part of the universe, which is great. So I have no doubts that this is all going to sort of settle into my mind in a bit.
Do you guys find, this is a little bit of a tangent, but it could be a fun one. Do you guys find that you use Magic lingo in your everyday life?
Oh, yeah. I've told Josh that you can never sack out at your friends when you're playing with them. You can't just like be like, ah, oh, screw you, I'm not going to play. Like, you can't, you have to be like really careful with that. I've told Josh when I'm really tired, I'm all tapped out.
Yeah. The tapped out thing. I've actually accidentally said that among people who didn't like play Magic, and you're like, oh man, I'm tapped out, and you're just like, I'm done, I'm tired.
Yeah,
because they're like, what?
Yeah, it slips in, and like you just don't even think about it after a while. You say things to your friends, and then the weird part of the thing is when it goes to the next step, and you've sat around your friends for so long that they don't play Magic but start using your terminology. I remember Zach Hill, who used to work in Magic R&D, told me a story once about he was on his school's mock trial club, and he like was very high up in it. They were a great team. But Zach loves Magic lingo. If you've never met him, he just spouts it off like nothing else, and no matter what context he's in. And eventually, like, it just perpetuated through the team and then other people in the school because he just kept saying
it. Oh, wow. an influence. That's amazing.
So, that's like years later, they say it somewhere, and somebody who plays Magic is like, you play Magic? They're like, no. What's that?
What's that? Yeah.
Yeah, you know, if I lose a bunch of time, I'll be like, I got time walked, you know? Like, all kinds of crazy stuff. I love Magic lingo. It makes me happy.
I think it's also great to just like sometimes we'll see something in real life that is an equivalent of a Magic card, and I'll just like say a word to Craig and he'll just crack up because it's just like that small little hidden joke that no one else knows that you're referring to. It's just a lot of fun. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like when you see a real word out in the world that's like a popular Magic card. Yeah. Like whenever I see something that's described as like tooth and nail, I'm just like, ah, it's like tooth and nail.
Two card combos that go infinite, tooth and nail. That's right. All I think about. I am excited though because the Wedges give me names for some of my favorite commanders. Like Annamar, I know, is now a Temur, which is great.
Right, yeah, because before it was just like you'd have to list the colors, which is kind of a pain in the butt. So now you can just it's a lot faster. It's shorthand.
It makes me wonder, and Alex was wondering this too, if there was any like real world affiliation with some of these names. Like Sultai is like, I see the word Sultan, even though I'm sure it has nothing to do with it, but like the colors, like he was saying Egypt with bug, you know, he's trying to figure out if there's some kind of connection there. Like some kind
of. They do look like they have some real world influences. Yeah. Is that another part of the design process?
Well, yeah, the creative team definitely always looks at all the stuff in the world when they're trying to, I mean, they want everything to be cohesive and sound as good as possible. So if you look at like Theros, I mean, this is a very stark example, but like everything kind of feels like you're in Greek mythology, right? Mm-hmm. And so when we were designing Khans of Tarkir and they figured out what the world was going to be like, they made sure to give the clans names to represent that. Mm-hmm. So you'll see more of that when the set comes out. But yeah. But there's a methodology behind everything that creative does. They're smart people.
Right. I think this entire set and this entire, all the wedges and all the different colors and just how flavorful it is, I think it's going to be a lot of fun for Commander too. Like in Theros, I think the gods all were awesome cards to put in your Commander decks because monocolored or not, they all had so much flavor and they could really help specific archetype decks like really work, like Xenagos and aggro and stuff. So I'm excited because I think the wedges and the legendary leaders of each house all have the potential to be commanders.
Well, yeah, I mean, you guys got a little bit of a taste of that, right? With Zergo Helm Smasher.
Yeah, Zergo Helm Smasher is...
Who's definitely, he can be a commander. In fact, I'm already thinking of ways to build, make a commander deck around him.
Yeah, I think this is pretty assumed that, you know, we're going to have a lot of great commander cards in here. And they will be great for the set, and they're not going to be great just for one thing or the other. I think finding the replayability of a lot of these, sort of the cons of each of the clans, like Sidisi, is that her name?
Yeah, Sidisi.
Sidisi, I think it's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, let me ask you, because you've had a chance, obviously, to play around with the set and everything, what's your favorite wedge?
I would say the clan I affiliate with is Obzon, which is actually not natural if you know anything about like my play history.
Yeah, they're the slow controlly one, right?
Yeah,
the
white, black,
survival,
green.
I think Mark Rosar said.
Yeah, black, green, white. It's not for any really natural reason. The reason is just that when I was playing internally, I kept playing Obzon decks. And I kept like, you know, being the voice for the Obzon tribe.
Getting your sticker on the we'll talk about the experience you're designing in a bit, but...
I was, you know, kind of the voice for the Obzon, and eventually, actually in the office, some people called me Captain Obzon.
Captain Obzon.
You're that well known for...
I mean, in R&D, not in other places, right. But...
Someday, if you get a card
now in other places,
you,
Gavin, now wherever you go.
Adam Prozac gave me that name, so...
Nice.
That should be your costume for Comic-Con next year, Captain
Obzon. Captain
Obzon.
I'm imagining it now.
You have a big shield with whatever there.
Yeah, but I'm assuming you've drafted this many times now.
I've definitely played a lot of cons, yeah.
Yeah.
And it's exciting. I mean, I can't say anything about it, but it'll be a fun format.
Jimmy, what do you think your, you know, just based on blind speculation, what do you think your favorite wedge is going
to
be?
I would say Jeskai, because they seem the most Asian to me, and I'm not, you know, anything but super Asian, and I love martial arts and all that. But Temur, I think, is actually one of my favorites. I don't know if, you know, it's going to take me to actually seeing all the cards, but right now, based on what I like to do in Commander, I think Temur is...
I'm surprised, because Mardu's the one that's centered in red, and you're Jimmy the Red.
I am Jimmy the Red, but aggro scares me, man. It scares me, because it's like, if it doesn't happen, then you really lose. You lose hard.
But that happens with control, too. If it doesn't happen, then...
But then control, at least you're guaranteed at least more than six turns. Aggro's like, uh-oh, SpaghettiOs.
I think Sultai is going to be my favorite.
Sultai, yeah.
Yeah, I just... they do what it takes to win, and they have the... I think Mark Rosewater said that their mechanic had something to do with managing resources. So, I don't know. I just like the sound of that.
Yeah, I mean, every clan has their own mechanic. So, I mean, really, like, identifying with one now is awesome. It's like, yeah, I want to be this, I want to be that. But once you see the mechanics, especially, it'll be like, okay, this is the kind of thing I like doing, you know?
Yeah, I'll say this is going to be one of the most fun pre-releases I think I'm ever going to go to.
Oh, I'm definitely going to draft Mardu because it's so fun to just kill people on turn five or six if you can, yeah.
I know that Craig's favorite is Abzan because of his commander, Caridor. And he goes to town with that guy. And I will say this much. If Abzan is as close to as powerful as it is in Commander, then hopefully... I mean, I can't wait to see what happens. Just because I love... I mean...
I've just been killed by that deck too many times. So
yeah, we've all been killed by it too many times. So another big thing about the pre-release, what was the design choice to... I mean, obviously you heard player feedback and everyone... I mean, it's sort of a recurring trend, but there's going to be 40 pre-release cards, 8 for each color.
Yeah, this is really one of your areas of expertise, right? Because you're in charge of...
Experience design. Yeah. So we've definitely been listening to a lot of player feedback, especially, you know, with the box model going all the way through Theros. And I think the boxes do a lot of great things, and that helps new players build decks, helps you build what you want to. But one part that wasn't really satisfying us was the fact that everyone got the same pre-release rare because you'd play against the same thing over and over.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And also, you know, it just meant there's less variety in games. Like, even if you had the rare, maybe you just kept playing it and winning, and that's not quite as satisfying.
Right. I saw a lot of Resolute Archangels from M15.
Right.
That's for sure.
And so this time around, we're doing something a little different. Inside, you'll choose a box based on your clan. Mm-hmm. So you can be, you know, Mardu or Temur or, you know, whatever you feel like.
You're going to be Obzon
for me. Absolutely. Yeah. And you pick your clan, and inside is a seed booster with one of 8 different pre-release rares. So you're very unlikely to play against the same pre-release rare twice in the same pre-release.
Right.
And you're even really unlikely to play against someone else who has the same rare that you do, because you have to play against your own clan, and them have the same box that you did. So do you really add a lot of variety.
Do you think that pre-release rare will push your deck building from that sealed pool into a different direction based on that?
Well, definitely. So, I mean, the seed packs inside the boxes correspond to your clans to push you into building a clan deck because, you know, you choose teamer. It's pretty lame if the right thing to do is not build a teamer deck. And we saw this sometimes happen in Theros, which was really unfortunate, where, like, you pick the red box, but your red cards just weren't good enough to make it happen. Yeah. And with clans, finally, you know, you're going to be three colors. You're going to want to build these three-color decks, and we're going to make sure that you have the tools to do that.
Awesome. I think it's a really cool idea, too, because, you know, I don't know if a lot of people do this, but we definitely go to more than one pre-release, and it feels like, you know, even if you like one color, it's like, I kind of have to go with another one because I already had that pre-release promo, and, you know,
right.
This way you could play the same clan a couple of times, and you're going to get a different, I mean, you got a 1-in-8 chance of getting the same one, so you got that's not going to happen very often, so you can try the same clan again. Yeah, I think it's really smart. It's great that you guys are listening to, you know.
I think it's also going to affect the meta a lot. You know, now that you're like, okay, I'm not just playing against one color. I have to worry about three different guaranteed things that, you know, the more you play, you'll know more about it. But it's like, I think it's really going to affect how you play each game, which is cool.
And deck building, we talked about this a little bit earlier with Commander. I mean, deck building a three-color deck is always really tricky. You have to get your mana right. Mm-hmm. You have to make sure that, you know, you have the right cards in your deck. And the seed pack just aims to help do that. So even a brand new player can get a deck together that's pretty competitive.
Yeah, true. Three color can be pretty daunting, especially if you're new. But we're assuming there's going to be a lot of good fixing and whatnot.
And you guys test the crap out of
this. You guys just need a fixing seed pack in there also.
Right? Just one seed pack of just like special lands. I mean, you guys test the crap out of this, right? You play so much of it just to make sure that everything works.
Yeah, we definitely play test a lot and try and get this as close as possible. And I think with cons, we ended up in a really good spot. So.
Yeah.
Super exciting.
I'm excited also because I am part Mongolian. I don't know if you guys know this. So having the Khans of Tarkir, it feels flavorful to my life. So I'm pretty excited.
I think
excited
like
about
one
that.
In 200 people on the planet is
related to Genghis Khan.
Yeah, can trace their lineage back to Genghis Khan.
He was he's a popular guy. I'll just say that.
That's
much.
One way to put it.
Right. He
proliferated.
His influence has been felt around the world.
Yeah. Didn't Starfleet take him down though?
It took a long time for that menace
they
to
had to take
taken
him down twice actually.
Yeah, exactly. That's really funny. Let's talk about the game experience of the pre-release because that's something that you were focused in, and I think this is great. I loved the giant Garrick. It was funny seeing the pictures that would pop up around him. He sort of created his own viral sort of sensation around him because people could do funny things with it, and it was something that you guys didn't have to push for at all. It was something that was the player created, player driven, you know, posing with the axe or just like putting a t-shirt on and putting a silly hat on him. I think it was great, and it's like, it's cool. It's a very iconic set piece when you walk into any your local game store too, so kudos on that.
Thanks.
I mean, it's been awesome to see the evolution of the pre-release and that type of event from just even a few years ago, and how it's really like you guys have really like started to focus on it a lot, and it's really improved drastically over just the last couple of pre-releases. Even like you can really see like big steps being made, you know. And I guess that's probably how long have you been part of that team? I mean, I'm not trying to like pat you on the back, but like you guys have done an awesome job of like really changing what the pre-release was even just a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm. So I started working on branded play stuff, experience design stuff, really kind of mid-Theros block. Mm-hmm. And I started working with Dave Guskin, who is an awesome, awesome designer, really, really smart. And so we worked some on some of the Theros block stuff. And then my first big task was with M15, kind of creating some of the experiences there. So I made the...
Oh, cool.
Like inside your pre-release box, you got the Garrick the Slayer card that you could play against. And that
which was really cool, yeah.
And that was me and Ethan Fleischer designed that, and then Adam Prozac developed
it. By the way, that Garrick was hard to beat.
Yeah, that was a true challenge.
Yeah. I had a pretty good sealed pool in the first one. I couldn't beat that.
Yeah, it's really interesting that it's really good against some decks and not as good against other decks. Mm-hmm. You can play with a wide variety of decks and have a different experience. And, you know, it's not the kind of thing that will necessarily last 10, 20 games, but for, you know, the... Yeah. Handful you're playing at the pre-release, it's a good
it was
time.
A great way to kill time if you just happen to be in a fast match and there's a lot, you know,
and it's cool.
Somebody's still on game one, you're done, so it's like something to do. Yeah, it's great.
So then I worked on a bunch of the stuff for Khans of Tarkir block, and Dave Guskin has actually since left the company, so I was kind of leading the charge on a bunch of stuff we did in Khans, and Dave's had his handiwork in some of the Khans of Tarkir stuff, but I definitely put my thoughts in there too, so
that's awesome.
Great.
Well, I'm really excited. If you guys don't know, you're getting pins and stickers, essentially, that you get to put on the banner of your store to show what of the wedges has been the triumphant one. Right. Who's being represented the most.
You keep your pin for yourself, which is awesome. You get to wear that around. And then, you get a sticker that you get to put up on a banner. And we're going to send the stores actually one banner for each clan. They can hang in their store and proudly represent the five clans of Tarkir.
Plus, from a spiky perspective, you can sort of see what clans everybody's playing,
and then you can
choose, the clan that you think maybe counters that clan a little bit more.
Yeah. If you want to go that deep at a pre-release, knock yourself out.
I do, Gavin.
We do stuff like this just for you, Josh.
Yeah. From an R&D standpoint, do you think any of the wedges are going to be slightly more popular, or people are going to go for those ones a little more just because of traditional color choices that they like?
Well, I do think it'll be pretty even, especially once people start seeing the cards and the mechanics.
Right.
I will say that just even talking to people here at the con, like, for some reason, Jeskai is the one most people will immediately affiliate themselves with.
Right,
but, that's without seeing any of the cards or mechanics or anything like that.
I think especially at a place like Comic-Con where there's, like, super hardcore gamers, people that are playing Magic for, 20 years or whatever, like me, like, we just naturally associate ourselves with blue.
Yeah.
Just because blue for early Magic was so powerful, so dominant. It just sort of carries through. I think anybody I talk to that played Magic in the early years, like, blue's by far their favorite color. I mean, that's been sorted out since, and blue's not the most powerful color, but if you just look at the early stuff, did anybody not play blue back in, like, Alpha, Beta, Arabian Nights days? Like, you had to have blue in there. You just weren't going to win.
Healing Solve, Gain 3 Life, Ancestral Recall, draw 3 cards. Yeah. Take your pick. But, also, the art for some of the Jeskai stuff is sweet. One of my favorite pieces we showed at the panel yesterday was the piece of that monk taking down that orc where it's like in mid motion. That is just a masterful piece of artwork.
Not to mention the one piece of artwork where someone was punching the heck out of a bear.
Oh yeah,
dude, that one is sick. Yeah. What's the name of that guy that's punching the bear? The
Surak Dragonclaw.
Surak, you said that one. Yeah.
Yeah.
He's got
it's like that slow mo, like you punch in the face. Yeah. And
I love art like that too because it's of course flavorful, but it's also just fun and good art that is simultaneously entertaining and funny. Not to a degrading point, but it's like it knows what it is, it knows exactly what it's doing, and it elicited the exact reaction I thought it would, which was just cheers and people loving the heck out of it.
We definitely like to make sure that every set has a little bit of everything, right? So if you look at our art and flavor text, you'll sometimes have really serious ones and sometimes ones that are a little more goofy. I'm really glad we can put cards like that in the set.
Oh, I guess last thing about cons is that Morph is returning as a so we had Convoke in M15, which I think was great. That really affected how I drafted. Every time I saw a card with Convoke, I was like, okay, so this is actually very differently costed than I'm imagining, which is cool. Morph, I feel like, has that sort of same effect on Limited, just because it opens up a whole new world of things that can happen.
Morph is a really cool mechanic and good in EDH in that, like, because all of warfare is based on deception, right? So just the fact that you've put something out on the board and nobody knows exactly what it is, but it's still sort of a threat. Like in EDH, you can do stuff like somebody's about to do something to you. You got a morph card on the table and you're like, just tap it a couple of times.
Yeah.
You sure you want to do stuff? This could be anything.
Well, and the great thing about morph and something like Commander too is you have the benefit of every morph card we've ever made that you could be tricking opponents with, right?
Exactly. They don't know what the heck it is. Yeah. It's great.
Yeah. I'm excited for some hopefully powerful morph cards in cons, at least that can affect Limited a lot. Because it's great. It's almost that you're playing with an extra card, right? Something that they know you have and they know does a certain thing, but they just have no idea what it is.
There's nothing quite like the terror of a face down card. It's probably nothing. It could be something.
Yeah.
It's nothing. Oh, but what if I die? Or they attack you with a face down card.
Yep.
And you're like, should I block?
Yep.
Should I not block?
It's the worst because I can't attack you with a card in my hand. And a morph card is the closest thing to a card that's in my hand.
Yeah.
You don't know what those are either. But there's something just way more terrifying when it's tapped and coming at you on the battlefield. Yeah. And it's just like, if I don't block, am I just dead? But if I do, am I just not?
Am I going to trade?
Is it stupid?
So poorly?
Am I just blown out? It's the worst. Yeah. It's going to be so awesome.
Well, it's like how Brian talks about. It's like when you're on the beatdown and the other person doesn't realize it, you can just get. I mean, it could just be. That's the best thing is like free swings.
Oh yeah.
It's a free 2 points of damage because they're so scared. Otherwise, it's like that's amazing. Where your ability to essentially scare them has turned them to inaction.
It really brings out bluffing. I mean, bluffing's a huge thing with morph cards. So pretty great.
So it'll be exciting.
Pretty exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Speaking of good times, Gavin, just wanted to say thanks for coming and chatting with us today. Where can we find you on the worldwide interwebs?
everywhere. You know, you can find me on Twitter at Gavin Verhey, just first name, last name, super easy. No one else has my name as far as I'm concerned. So, nice. And if they do, they're not, they certainly don't show up higher than me in Google search results. So
you have a blog, correct?
I have. Yeah. You can find me on Tumblr, Gav Insight, very clever name because it's a pun.
I do like it. I saw it yesterday when they were listing all the people at the panel. I was like, Gav Insight. That's brilliant.
Well, you know what's funny is I'd seen that before, but I never put it together until somebody actually said it out loud. I know I'm dense, but I was like,
Having a name that ends in IN is awesome. You can do like Gav Insight, Gav Intelligence, Gav Inquiry, all kinds of stuff. I'm working on getting together a YouTube channel right now, and I'm trying to figure out like what kind of name I want to use for that.
Gav Incredible.
Gav right. Incredible.
There, done. Of, sold. No, just
Gav Vabson.
That's it. I got it for you. It's free. Don't worry. You don't have to pay me. It's cool.
I don't know. Do you guys know anything about YouTube? I'm not sure if you guys are supposed to be talking to about this.
Yeah. Well, when it comes out, we'll definitely make sure to blast out all your stuff because all your content's great. Your articles are wonderful reads every time I peruse them.
Oh, right. Yeah, definitely. If you want to check out my articles, I have an article on Tuesday on Daily MTG. That's called Reconstructed, where I rebuild decks and talk about like some basics of deck building. So if you're just getting into Magic, if you maybe you're kind of like, I don't know how to build a deck well, there's a lot of great stuff on there. And if you're especially really new to Magic, I would recommend go back, just Google, and it should be one of the first things that comes up. Search how to build a Magic deck. There's an article I wrote that really takes you through the basics of deck building. And every time a new player gets into the game, I always tell them, go check that article out because it really is a good resource and I got a ton of good feedback on it.
Yeah.
And if you don't know, Daily MTG is on the Wizards website, what they call the mothership. And if you just go under Magic, you'll see Daily MTG is one of the tabs. And you can look at all your archived stuff if you just click on Gavin's name. So definitely check that stuff out. He's a smart dude and he knows a little bit about the game.
I've been writing Magic articles for 9 years now. So I mean, on different websites, not all on Daily MTG, but you can just go to dailymtg.com or go to, you know, Wizards and navigate to the Magic area and you'll find it. But also Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Tumblr, you can find me in places. I'm pretty easy to find. So.
Awesome. Well, Gavin, thanks so much. So glad you
really appreciate it.
Oh, it was totally my pleasure, guys. This was a great, great show. It was fun doing work with you, and maybe in the future I'll be back on again.
Yeah, maybe we'll play a match too, and we'll see.
We could ever like record a match live and have Josh do dramatic commentary from the sidelines.
I'll side in my Blightsteel Colossus.
You can steal it and kill him with it. It'll be awesome.
Yeah, that's how we hire a whole film crew, but we only have 20 minutes to film it. So we're like,
all right, guys, turn fives. We got to win.
Right. Let's make it fast.
Yeah. Oh, I also want to mention Gavin had a sweet Jace cosplay outfit that he was in.
Oh, my gosh.
And I'm only saying it right now so that I have an excuse to put it up on the video as I'm talking about it right now. So if you're looking at it, cool. If you're only listening to us, you're going to have to go find the picture on the show notes or something.
Yeah, I'm a big cosplayer, and I love representing my game. So being able to be Jace is exciting. I mean, plus he's like one of my favorite Planeswalkers.
He is pretty sweet.
I mean, it's maybe stereotypical to say, but I love Jace. So.
You know what? I think I love Jace too.
Let's group hug, guys, for
group
Jace.
Group hug for Jace.
All right. And on that note,
we're doing the most awkward group hug ever.
Yeah, we're like, our hands are kind of touching, but not really touching. We're like all too afraid to touch each other because our kinetic energy will like short the computer.
Yeah,
also,
exactly.
I'm kind of sweaty because it's hot.
Yeah, it is hot in here. Anyway, guys, thanks so much for tuning in. Make sure you check out the podcast and subscribe to our RSS feed. All that good stuff. We'll be back next week talking about more Magic the Gathering, Command Zone stuff. Exciting. I'm Jimmy Wong.
I'm Justin Kwai.
And I am Gavin Verhey.
Peace out.
Peace.
Thank you for your attention. For further inquiries, send an email to commandcast@rocketjump.com or ask us on Twitter at JF Wong and at Josh Lee Kwai. See you later, alligator.
Greetings, humans.